Come one, come all. To the show where former football stars tell their stories. Plus the 12th Man segment with Sports One Marketing. It's all right here, right now, on Thursday Night Tailgate. With your hosts, Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari. Guys, take it away.
Hey, good evening, everybody, and thank you for joining us again tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. I'm your host, Chris Mascaro, and tonight, Bob and I, like we do every single week here on TNT, have seven great guests in store for you tonight. We've got a former Heisman Trophy winner who's going to join us here shortly. We've got another one of the great quarterbacks from the 70s back with us on the show. Always look forward to talking to him. We've got three former Steelers, so heads up, Steelers Nation, three former Steelers on the show tonight, plus a former Saints tight end who's doing some great things now for some of his former peers. And as you know, we also have David Meltzer from Sports One Marketing in our weekly 12th Man segment. So, you know, it's going to be another great night here on Thursday Night Tailgate. We are so glad you've made the choice to share this night and these next couple of hours with us. So like we say every single week, relax, settle in. Let us take your mind off everything else going on in your life for the next couple of hours. And let's do so the very best way, kicking off the show by bringing in my co-host, Mr. Bob Lazzari. Good evening, Bob. How are you tonight, my friend?
Good evening. How are you, Chris? I'm doing okay.
I'm doing all right, Bob. I got to tell you, I've had the back-to-back, if you will, week I've had a Boston week, my friend. I went to go see checked a little check mark on the bucket list. Got to see Boston in concert, something I've always wanted to see. You know, I'm a classic rock guy, so I got to see Boston in concert. And then I had either, you know, the privilege or the misfortune of going to the Red Sox Braves game last night. So I gave myself a little agita watching the Red Sox boot the ball and hit into multiple double plays and lose an embarrassing game here in Atlanta. But I've had a Boston sort of week, my friend.
You should have stopped after the first Boston stop, you know, Chris. I mean, I tell you, you have to realize how big they were up here in this area in the 70s. I saw them back in the day, Chris, and this is when Brad Delp was in full swing, and what a band. And I heard that you told us that they still sound pretty good.
Yeah, no, I was, God rest Brad Delp's soul for, you know, his passing and, the tragic way he did pass. But, their new lead singer, I thought, sounded really good. And, the rest of the band, a couple of original members still there, but I thought they sounded fantastic. I was very impressed with the sound that they put out. It was certainly well worth the money. I was a little skeptical going in, but coming out, well worth the money. If Boston is touring near you and you have an opportunity to check them out, if you love classic rock, you love their sound, you got to check it out. Those guys put on a heck of a show, did a great job, and sounded every bit as good as you remember them. So yeah, it was a good night.
Similar things have been said about Journey, Chris. I mean, I guess when you're so good and have such a great body of work, you're going to get someone to replace them, and they still sound great. And you know all about Journey also.
Yeah, you know, that's music to my ears, pun intended. You know, they're my favorite band of all time. So, yeah, and, you know, Neil Sean, Jonathan Cain, the boys still sound great. So, yeah, it's two great bands if they're touring, and they're out touring around. So if you have an opportunity to check them out, you're definitely not going to get disappointed.
We're going to have a hard rock week one of these weeks, Chris, just talking hard rock for a while. I don't know, maybe you
might catch up. Brother, I've been trying to get Neil Sean on this show for years, and when I thought I got real close once, they're from San Francisco and big 49ers fans, so I got close once. I didn't get to pull it off, but that's still on my list to do. I promise you that.
We'll get it done.
So, Bob, you know, one of our guests that we've got back tonight, when you think of great quarterbacks of the 70s, and then we all start our list off with, Bradshaw, Staubach, Kenny Stabler, Bob Greasy, you know, guys in the Hall of Fame. But right after them, I think in the next layer, Bob, I think you had to include, guests we've had the last couple of weeks. We had, Greg Landry, recently on the show, and tonight one of our guests, Dan Pastorini. Those guys got to be in the upper echelon of the quarterbacks of the 70s, do they not?
Oh, absolutely. We talked to Pastorini a couple months back, Chris. I think of my father, because my father would not call him Dan. Dante Pastorini. That was from the words of his lips. He loved the guy because he could punt. Remember we talked about him
right.
Punting also. And he was just a great athlete and played other sports. And we'll get into that in a bit. But I totally agree. And he played for some bad teams, Chris.
Yeah, absolutely he did. Couple years, back-to-back 1-13 years, poor guy. But, yeah, we'll get into that. And Dan's one of our guests later on tonight. All right, TNT is brought to you by former Bengals and Falcons tight end Reggie Kelly and the great folks over at Kaivin Foods. Be sure to spice up everything on your menu by adding Kaivin's salsas, sauces, and spices to whatever you've got cooking. Check them out online at kaivin82.com, and Kaivin is K-Y-V-A-N, the number 82.com, to see all of their great products. We're also sponsored by Dr. Peter Candelora and the great folks over at Coastal Orthopedics. If it hurts when you get out of bed in the morning, folks, do yourself a favor. Check out Coastal Orthopedics. Find them online at bone-dr.com for more information. Do what the gridiron greats do to get relief, and that's contact Coastal Orthopedics. Again, bone-dr.com to find out more information about them online. And like we say, with the Red Sox baseball season, certainly in full swing, we got, kids getting out of school now. Summer vacations are starting up. If you love baseball, you need to go check out the Louisville Slugger Museum and Factory. If you haven't been, folks, you got to go. Put that on your list of things to do this summer. You get to see the actual bats of your favorite major league stars being made right before your very eyes, because you get to walk their actual live production line, and you get to see the full process going on right there in front of you. And, they're going to let you know whose bats those are. Like I said, a couple times on this show, I got to see Derek Jeter's bats made, being made right before his last season last year. So great stuff. A lot of fun. For more information and to book your visit, go to sluggermuseum.com. And we want to give a shout out to our friends over at the Gridiron Greats organization. We always appreciate what they do to take care of the guys who played long before there were six-figure salaries and even, no health care coverage, that sort of thing. Mike Ditka and that organization are doing great things to, help those guys now that they are later on in life and they need some help. And believe it or not, guys way back when, guys in the 50s, 60s, 70s that played, they weren't playing for the 18, million dollars, the 7, 8, 9-figure salaries that these guys are playing for now. So kudos to those guys. To find out more information about what Coach Ditka is doing to help those folks, go to gridirongreats.org. All right, so let's go through all of our guests tonight. First up in our 12th man segment with Sports One Marketing CEO and best-selling author David Meltzer is going to be former Steelers and Patriots punter Josh Miller. Josh is a TNT alum. He's been on the show with us in the past, so we're excited to have him back with us. We'll hear what he and David are working on together when they join us here in just a few minutes. Following them is going to be former Heisman Trophy winner Johnny Rodgers. Remember Johnny at the University of Nebraska? What a great run he had at the University of Nebraska. He was scheduled to be with us a few weeks ago, but had something come up at the last minute. So we're excited to have him with us tonight. Johnny's going to make it back-to-back Nebraska Hall of Famers on TNT. Remember, we had Mike Minter last week. So Johnny here, both of them are in the Nebraska Hall of Fame. Johnny had a great career, started off on the pro football side. He decided to go up to the CFL, which was something in the mid-70s. It wasn't all that foreign. We had Joe Pisarczyk on a couple of months ago. Joe did the same thing because it was actually more lucrative, if you can believe it, to go play up in the CFL. And Johnny started his career up there before coming back down here to the NFL and a knee injury cutting his great career short. Johnny is also about to have a street named after him in his community up in North Omaha. So on top of his many honors being in the College Football Hall of Fame and the Nebraska Hall of Fame, he's going to have a street named after him right outside of where his office is. So we'll talk about that, his great career at Nebraska, his time in Canada, and the knee injury that cut it all too short. Johnny's going to be here about 20 minutes from now. He'll be followed by our second former Steeler of the night, and it's a guy who was also our very first guest on this show nearly 4 years ago, and that's Levon Kirkland. We'll talk with Levon more about his time in Pittsburgh. Did he look forward to training camp, or was it, you know, I sort of envisioned training camp being like, you know, we get out of school, it's summertime, and now all of a sudden it's over and you got to go back to school. I wonder how they viewed going to training camp. So we'll talk about that with him. We'll get his perspective. You know, Levon did have a year in Seattle, so I'm also kind of curious to get his thoughts on how the Super Bowl ended. We'll talk about all of that when he's here about 35 minutes from now. Later this hour, former Saints tight end Boo Williams will be making his TNT debut. Boo played 4 years with the Saints, also had some time with the New York Giants, and played in the Arena League with the Kansas City Brigade. He's doing some great work now with the Crosby Centers with the NFL PA. You know, the Crosby Centers helps guys that dealing with concussions and head trauma. So Boo's heavily involved there. So we look forward to talking about his playing career, plus the great things he's doing now. And he'll be here about 50 minutes from now. We'll kick off the next hour with Dan Pastorini. We'll talk to Dan about, you know, his peers, you know, from around the league and his tenure in the league, and, you know, what it was like playing with some of those and against some of those great quarterbacks of the 70s. He certainly had his fair share of playing against Ken Stabler, obviously twice, you know, twice a year against Terry Bradshaw. We'll talk about that. Plus, you know, he got into drag racing in life after the NFL, beat you know, Big Daddy Don Garlitz in drag racing. So what was that like? And did that fill the void of competition for him after his NFL career? We'll find out a little over an hour from now. And then we're going to wrap up the show with our third former Steeler of the night, former Steeler Super Bowl champion fullback Carey Davis. He was a part of the Steeler Super Bowl winning team in 2005. That team, you know, our friend last week, Ken Hamlin, said robbed the Seahawks of that championship. We'll hear what Carey thinks about that statement when he joins us about 90 minutes from now. So as always, folks, we are wall to wall with great guests to share with you here on Thursday Night Tailgate. And like I say, we thank you for being a part of it and taking the journey with Bob and me over the next couple of hours. We like to get the ball rolling every week by saluting our brave men and women serving in our military that are listening in tonight on the Armed Forces Radio Network. We want to pass along our deep and sincere thanks to all of our veterans and everyone currently serving in every branch of the military and public service. You folks are so incredible for what you do for the rest of us. We thank you for the sacrifices that you make and your families make, and certainly for our veterans, for the sacrifices that you made for every single one of us. We truly appreciate what you do to protect the freedoms that we all have and the liberty that you provide to us that allows the rest of us to do what we do. Our sincere thanks as well to Sean Cruz and all the folks over at the Armed Forces Radio Network. It's an honor for us to be a part of your network. You can find us by going to armedforcesradionetwork.org. And for the veterans listening in tonight, be sure to check out globalvoiceforveterans.org. It's a great site with a wealth of information for our veterans. You got news on there, articles specifically geared towards our veterans. I'm sure you're going to find both interesting and beneficial. Go check it out, globalvoiceforveterans.org. And I also want to remind you the other places that you can find Thursday Night Tailgate. You can stream or download us from our site, ThursdayNightTailgate.com. Plus, our friends over at Boost Radio are streaming us every Friday night from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern Time. Go to BoostRadioNetwork.com and click on the on-air link you're going to find in the upper right-hand corner of their homepage to hear us. You can also find us on iHeartRadio, TuneIn, Spreaker, SoundCloud, Audio Boom. Big shout-out to our good friends over at Audio Boom that are featuring our show every single week now. You can also download us on iTunes. Plus, if you're, you know, out and about, you can take us with you everywhere you go by downloading the Stitcher or Player.fm app as well. All right, before we get to our first guest on the 12th Man segment with Dave Meltzer, a word from our friends over at Kyven Foods.
This is Reggie Kelly, former Cincinnati Bengals and Atlanta Falcon tight end, and I'm the owner of Kyven Foods. And if you enjoy delicious food, you're going to love my Kyven products, which consists of our honey apple salsa, sweet barbecue sauce, and an array of seasonings. For store locations, online orders, and recipes, check out our website at www.kyven82.com. That's KYVAN82.com. One taste and you'll appreciate the goodness.
All right, now joining us on the Kyven Foods guest line in our weekly 12th Man segment is Sports One Marketing CEO and best-selling author David Meltzer. And his special guest tonight is former Steelers and Patriots punter and the author of the book Always a Home Game, Our Journey Through Steelers Country in 140 Days. And a copy of that book just happens to be sitting right here next to me. Good evening, Dave. How are you and Josh tonight?
Yeah, I'm doing amazing. Such a pleasure to have a Steeler night. I mean, it's a little tough being a Buckeye. Glad to have the world champions on with us all day long. So congratulations on that.
Thank you.
How's everyone doing?
Hey, Josh.
How are you?
Good.
Now, I want to say the most impressive thing about Josh Miller, and I know, you know, my mentor Lee Steinberg is a member of this organization. But Josh, isn't it true that you're in the Jewish Hall of Fame?
I am. I really am, and I wish it was. A bigger deal than it is. I went in with a guy who skipped the rock 17 times. So, I mean, they take anybody.
Well, that's what I'm hoping. The reason I'm bringing it up is I'm hoping that you're on the nomination committee because I really want to get in. They put me in. I think I've been working my way up with the best-selling book and CEO of that company for a while. I was hoping I could get a few extra people. Sean Green, he told me he'd give me his support. I got Josh Miller, Lee Steinberg. Maybe hopefully I can get a nomination in the next 10 years. What do you think?
There's no doubt about that. Absolutely. I'll definitely.
I'm the perfect pair, too, because I was a Jewish punt returner. I just played Division III, though, so not quite to the level of a Pittsburgh Steeler and Super Bowl winner like you. But thank you so much for coming on. And I wanted to bring you on because I know, you know, we're working on syndicating your great show, and it's just getting such rave reviews. And I was hoping you could tell our audience that keeps growing about the day in the life of and what you're doing and what it is. And I think it'd be great for more people to understand this really significant show that you're doing.
Sure. It'd be my pleasure. You know, it's funny how things happen. You map out how you want things to go, and then suddenly an idea pops and you're headed in another direction. You drop everything you've been working on. I retired from football. And I thought I can fish and golf the rest of my life, and I'd be happy with it. But my mind has had other things on its plate. I was very bored, and my son took me in first grade to career day, and he looked up at me. He's like, "What are you going to tell him?" I'm like, "What do you mean?" He's like, "You don't do anything." So I was like, "Okay." I went home, told my wife, "We're moving from Jupiter, Florida. We're getting the hell out of here. You know, where are we most happy?" And we came to the conclusion it was Pittsburgh, great place to raise a family. We went back there. We've been here for 5 years now. I got a job on the radio. I'm like, "Okay, see, son, look, you need a life. You need to go out and do things and show up and come back, have responsibilities and things of that nature." Then the next thing hits me where my son's like, "Dad, you ever punch mom in the face?" I'm like, "No, of course not. Never punched mom in the face." There were times where if I found a genie bottle, I may wish to be a woman for 5 minutes. But no, I've never hit your mother. Wouldn't even think of that. Of course not. He's like, "Oh, okay, Daddy." And I was like, "Dad, you smoke weed?" I'm like, "No, of course not." I kept everything in the closet. I'm like, "No, of course not."
He's not listening.
He said, "You know, Dad, you drive drunk." And I'm like, "No, of course." I'm like, "Cal, where are you getting this? Are these kids you're hanging out with? My goodness, I want you to live in a cartoon a little longer than 11 years. Where are you hearing this?" Sports Center. I was like, "You got to be kidding me." Okay, there you have it. So I'm like, you know what? I need to do something because, you know, that's fine if a lot of these athletes don't want to be role models, and that is fine. But a lot of these guys actually do. And a lot of these guys actually wake up and they appreciate the fact that they're playing a game for a living. They actually are using that opportunity to make their little world better, not their planet, but their little tiny world better. And I'm like, I need to capture that. It's amazing because, you know, the Penguins, the Steelers, and the Pirates, the University of Pittsburgh, you know, I showed them what my resume was, and it was blank. But I'm like, I got an idea here, and I'm not going to embarrass anybody. And I'm going to attack this kind of like I did football. I'm going to surround myself with a team that's better than me, and I hire people. I'm like, "Your job's not to make me look like a schmuck." And he's like, "Okay, I got it." And then you hire a production company. I'm like, "Your job is to make me look good." They said, "Okay, we got it." And this is my vision. This is what I want to do. And, you know, we talk to the players and say, "Hey, you know, listen, I know you have a cystic fibrosis walk Saturday night with your family. let us cover that. We're not going to be in your face interviewing, because that's not what it's about, and that's not what you want. But let us just witness that it happened. And along the walk, let me ask you a couple questions. And they said they'd love that. And then next thing you know, hey, listen, we're going to go out for lunch with the family. Let us just see you from a distance. We're not going to interview you or your wife or your child, clearly. But if you don't mind just letting us capture that and the walk, and maybe you're speaking to a fourth grade class tomorrow. I know that. Can we capture that from a distance as well? Sure. Well, that's a show. You know, Charlie Batch was our first one, our experimental one. I'm like, Charlie, let us follow you around. He's like, sure. Well, he did a commencement speech at La Roche College, not a dry eye in the house. Talked about his sister getting shot and how he started the Best of the Batch Foundation. And then he went to downtown at the Bayham Theater where he did Seussical the Musical, where he was the muscle man. And then he got inducted into the Western Pennsylvania Hall of Fame. And then he went home to walk his dog, Stephen Kraft. And that was a show. And it was great. And we bundled it up. And I'm like, see, Cal, look at that. Look what Charlie's doing. You see him. You know, you look at what Craig Adams is doing. Look at there. Look at Coach Dixon. You know, so now look at Jerome Bettis. Look at Mean Joe. And I'm like, we have a show here. And now all the teams were like, okay, you're actually working for us. You're making our image better. You're getting our guys out there, bridging more fans to these athletes. And you know how it is. If you ask a guy to sign autographs for 2 hours, you better give him $10,000, $15,000, $20,000, and it better not be an hour away, because that's
right.
These guys don't want to do that. But if you're going to tell a guy, hey, listen, I'm going to get your message out there, this is more or less an infomercial for you, let us walk around, walk a couple holes if you want to play golf, let us go catch some fish, set some hooks on some big fat bass, and just talk it out, and here you are, take your kids to the bus stop. And it took off, and it was great. And Root gave us an opportunity to do this, again, with no track record. And now we're going to be in the four other regions, in Seattle, Houston, and Denver. We're going to do the same thing there. My job's easy. I got to find another washed-up me somewhere else, which is easy, and let them host the show in this city that people would know who they are. And just show some good things going on, because there's a lot more good than bad. But as you know, it's not sexy enough to throw out there, so they don't put it on the big show.
Yeah, no doubt. In fact, what intrigued me most when talking to your producer about the show is that, you know, in my book, I talk about the greatness of kindness, and that not only the act of kindness creates this positive energy and releases serotonin in your brain and all these great things, but the person receiving the kindness, that happens too as well. And more importantly, it's proven that the people witnessing kindness have the same biochemical reaction and the same energy action. And so your show is so critical to project the positive aspects of not only these athletes, but the sports in general. And, you know, running a huge agency and now marketing Pro Football Hall of Fame. And, you know, I used to market some of your close friends at the Clemente Award and you know, the Humanitarian Award. It was always my aim or goal to promote the good aspect and the good people within sports, which is about 99% of them, let's be honest. And if you want to be critical of people, go to the Senate and Congress and percentage-wise, see what those guys are doing compared to our athletes. And they're a lot more educated and older. So, you know, I'm just so impressed by the idea of promoting kindness and generosity and positive energy that, you know, we, Warren Moon and I, my partner, wanted to be a part of it. I have this 12th man segment, this inspirational, aspirational segment that's through the Armed Forces Radio and iHeart and keeps growing and growing. And you're just an icon of someone that understands what we're trying to do here. And I'm glad that Chris honored you with all these other Steelers coming on. Chris, do you have any questions for Josh as well?
Oh, there's no question. So Josh, you know, you were kind enough to join us last year and we talked a little bit about your book. One of the things that I'm curious to know, I know you went you found Steeler bars in Baltimore. What was it like going or even just traveling to a Steelers bar in Baltimore in the heart of enemy territory?
Well, you know, it's funny because you're not tiptoeing in there because we're driving around a 36-foot RV fully wrapped in Steeler, always a home game, our logo. And, you know, we get, like I said, one of two fingers. You get the thumbs up or the other one. And people really wanted you to know where they stood. There was no hesitation. And, you know, you can't speed out of there because that thing, I promise you, doesn't go over 50 miles per hour. So we really absorbed it, took it all in. But they're everywhere. I mean, we were pleasantly surprised. The only place where we had to I think we used someone's living room and documented it as one was in Green Bay. Very impressed how Green Bay didn't have any Steeler bars. They had one guy who knocked on his door, went to his living room, said a prayer, threw an autographed certificate from Art and Dan Rooney on the living room wall and said, okay, this room now is Steeler bar. Goodbye. But it was, other than that, everywhere else had 6 to 10 bars in each, all 32 NFL markets. Believe it or not, Baltimore was a real nice trip. That was easy. The closest we came to being scared was Cincinnati. Cincinnati was an unbelievable memory for me because, you know, obviously I'm in the Jewish Hall, which my life is bizarre. I married an Italian girl who goes to church. Our kids have been baptized, first communions and all that. I have a 17-foot tree that's held up straight with a menorah. Because it tilts, so that's what we use to straighten it out. I lose every battle, So I'm there in Cincinnati in Christmas, and they happen to have a Santa crawl, the bar crawl. So there's 900 Santas within a block of each other. We're in a big Steeler wrapped, RV, so we're getting chased, and I was hilarious. So somewhere I'm like, this is like a Woody Allen nightmare. Where here's just at least 70 Santas chasing you, MFing you while they're drunk. And I'm just trying to find a Steeler bar here. And I know they know I'm not Jewish, but it just added that it was hilarious, the fact that they were chasing me, not liking me, because I was in my sled. They didn't appreciate too much. But that was the closest we came. New York, they were harmless. Seattle, I mean, everywhere was nice. The West Coast swing was good. The Keys, I will say, was probably I wish we could have stayed a little longer. That was a fun
I bet you do.
Now, my wife, I tried to sell her on Steeler golf courses across the country, but she told me no.
Nice try. That's a good try. Josh, just so our listeners know how to follow you, to Dave's point about your show and how they can check you out online and over social media, where can they find you? How can they find you?
I'm at Josh4 Miller, and with the little Twitter world, and I'm a boring follow. I'm not giving you dates or scores. I'm giving you, hey, I just had 74 marshmallows. Does anyone know if this is actually healthy? I'm that type of stuff. I'm also obviously a day in a life show.com is where you can find some of the episodes and things of that nature, and I'm easy to find. I do a radio show from, I wake up at 4 a.m. every day. Another thing that seemed to be a good idea at the time, to do a show Monday through Friday from 6 to 4:05 every day. I mean, now that I'm 40, as you guys know, you wake up that time to pee anyway. So I'm like, honey, I might as well just do the show. My day's done. And I can hang out with the kids at 10:30. I could be on the tee box anywhere. I work it out accordingly, selfishly. So life is good. I'm happy. I'm in a good place, and I really enjoy doing this show because, it's just amazing because these kids, parents always are convinced they know what the kids are thinking because that's what they're thinking at that age. That's crap. You can't think from a kid's eyes because you're not a kid. And sadly, these play dates and all this other stuff that we're forced to do in these, these timeouts and things like that. Well, we made it this far, and we didn't die along the way. So it's nice to just get in these little kids' heads and just say, you know what, be anything you want. I know you're being told you can't do this, you can't do that. And they live in such a tough time with these bullying and cyberbullying and all this social media. But I want them to know that their goals and their dreams, good luck finding me where it's written where they can't do it. It's just going to be 90% of kids get bogged down because they're told repeatedly, I can't. So they eventually say, I guess everybody must be right since I hear it all the time. Well, how about you can go for it? And if you can't, well, guess what? Everyone has an audible. Everyone has a plan B. Make sure you have that. But go for whatever it is that you want to do. And these kids and these athletes we follow deliver the same message.
That's great stuff.
Yeah, possibility, the probability, the perspective. You nailed it. What a pleasure to have you on.
No, thanks.
Dave, remind our listeners what you're up to and where they can go hear you speak.
Yeah, we're getting a little busy. So I got the Saturday Rock here in California and the Irvine Amphitheater. We'll have about 1,000 people. And then next on July 16th, doing the Octane Sports Technology Summit and keynoting that with one of my good friends, Mike Haynes. So he'll be the other keynote with me talking about sports, and I'm sure they'll stick me with the dorky Jewish technology stuff. But we're really excited. The mission meetings and the 30-day gratitude challenge and MeltzerMission.com is accelerating and gaining a lot of momentum. And we just appreciate you, Chris, and everything that you do. What a great show, and it's a privilege to be on it every week. And very, very excited to see what the future holds for all of us. I wanted to thank Josh and you, and have a wonderful evening.
I have one quick question for you guys. I need your opinion. I'm trying to write a book right now from all the Jewish athletes that play the game. Everyone has funny stories. But for the title of the book, I either have Who Let Jew In or Jew Don't Belong Here. And I don't know if any of those less offensive.
I like Jew Don't Belong Here. Or Where Are You? Where Are You?
I mean, who let Jew in or Jew Don't Belong Here? And I'm such a, I don't know which one to go with because there's a lot of us out there. But I think getting funny stories along the way would be a good read for our kids.
There you go. I like great. A, by the way, Josh.
Yeah, A is great. But I'm looking for my nomination, Josh. Don't let me down. I really
want to
get it.
I want you to write the forward. You got to be part of this.
No doubt. No doubt. I love it.
That's great stuff. Fellas, thank you so much for being a part of the show tonight. You guys are both great. Dave, we look forward to catching up with you again next week. Josh, we hope you'll come back and join us again. We'd love to have you on for a full segment.
I would love nothing more. Appreciate the time, guys. All the best.
All right. Take care, fellas. Have a good night.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Dave Meltzer and Josh Miller. I tell you what, Bob, you know, Dave with the MeltzerMission.com and how inspirational he is. Josh, on the other hand, hilarious.
Well, we have talked to him in the past, Chris. He talked about, well, he grew up this back out in the East here and should have his own comedy show. But people do forget he was an incredibly talented punter. Chris spent 3 years up here in New England and was almost at 44 yards per kick. And he's
right.
So well remembered here. So let's not forget what kind of athlete he was. But, man, what a funny guy.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, now joining us on the Kyven Foods guest line is Johnny Rodgers. Let me give you some background on Johnny, at least remind you about the extensive background that Johnny has. He was born in Omaha, Nebraska, so I'm guessing playing his college ball anywhere else besides the University of Nebraska was out of the question, but we'll find out in a moment. He went to Tech High and was named High School Athlete of the Year. Johnny was so fast, they nicknamed him the Jet. Like I said, played his college ball at the University of Nebraska and was a dynamic player. Played running back, wide receiver, and punt returner. Broke nearly every Nebraska offensive record there was. Was a two-time All-American. He won the Walter Camp Award, which is given to the College Player of the Year, and he won the Heisman Trophy in 1972. Set the NCAA record for all-purpose yards with nearly 5,600. Chose to play in the CFL instead of the NFL, and was a CFL All-Star every year from 1973 to 1976, and was Rookie of the Year in 73 as well. He helped the Montreal Alouettes win the Grey Cup in 1974. He came back and played 2 years in the NFL with the San Diego Chargers before a knee injury robbed us what I'm sure would have been a great NFL career. In 1999, Johnny was named to the Nebraska All-Century team. The following year, 2000, was named as Nebraska's Player of the Century. That year, he was also elected to the College Football Hall of Fame. In 2007, he was elected to the Omaha Sports Hall of Fame. And on Tuesday, the Omaha City Council passed a proposal to rename the street in front of where Johnny's high school used to be Johnny Rodgers Street. And we are certainly thrilled and honored to have Johnny with us tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Johnny, Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari here. Thank you for joining us.
You're very welcome, Chris and Bob. Nice to be here.
Thank you, Johnny.
So, Johnny, I got to ask you, you know, a street being named in your honor in your own community. I mean, on top of everything else, I mean, you've had so many wonderful honors, but now you got a street named after you. What's that feel like?
Well, it's all been rather a surprise to me. I guess one of my teammates in high school actually put in the proposal and did all the paperwork, and they by the time I figured it out, or they told me, it was almost already a foregone conclusion that it was going to pass the city council. So I just learned a couple of days ago and hasn't quite hit yet. We're going to have the ribbon cutting ceremonies on July 30th, right before the Nebraska Black Hall of Fame dinner.
So, I mean, that's fantastic. Good for you, Johnny. I you know, as I said in the intro, you know, as a kid from Omaha, was there ever any other option than you going to the University of Nebraska?
Yes, there was. I really had my heart set on going to USC.
Is that right?
I really wanted to go. But in the time that I was in high school, Nebraska in 68 and 69, they were 6-7. Or, you know, 6-6, something not very good. So I really didn't have an interest in really going to Nebraska. Matter of fact, that they hadn't won a championship since Jesus was a kid. so I had gotten drafted to the Los Angeles Dodgers to play baseball out of high school. And I went to visit, and also went to visit my father. I had never met my father. And so my father was going to pick me up at the airport, but I really didn't know what he looked like when I got there, because I was 17 years old and had never met him. But one thing that he did do is when he did take me around there in Los Angeles, he took me by the Coliseum and told me that Ernie Davis was the first African-American to win the Heisman Trophy. And then there was the second was Mike Garrett, who went to USC. And the third African-American to win the Heisman was O.J. Simpson. And that if I could go to SC, that I could probably, had a good chance to get into the professional career. And in my case, growing up, I always wanted to make $100,000. So I was trying to make $100,000, and I figured if I could get to SC, that I could actually make $100,000. Well,
from USC or in your career?
Pardon?
I was just curious. You can make $100,000 from USC or later in your career?
Later in my career, when I got to the pros, I didn't really realize that they actually paid athletes money. I still didn't know if OJ or Mike Garrett ever made any money in college, but I did know that they were both in the pros and had done very well, and yeah. I could do the same thing. When I came back to Nebraska, Charlie Washington, who was one of the my mentors here in Omaha, Nebraska, I had set up a meeting with Bob Devaney, and I really wasn't that thrilled to meet Bob Devaney, to really be honest with you. But I said I would do it because of my mentor, Charles Washington. Well, when I first saw Bob Devaney, I couldn't really believe it because he looked like Mr. Potato Head. And I couldn't believe he was such a famous coach. But he was. And he told me that he wanted to have national championships at Nebraska instead of Big 8 championships. And he wanted to have all Americans instead of all Big 8 players. And if I were to come to the University of Nebraska, that I could probably help make all that happen. And the state would support me wholeheartedly. And I told him that I really didn't have any interest in coming to Nebraska. That I was probably going to go to SC. And I had turned down a contract with the Los Angeles Dodgers to play baseball in high school. So what he told me was that if I went to Nebraska, that he would allow me to play baseball and play football. And if I were to do that, then I would be able to possibly negotiate a better deal to get $100,000. And that was the reason why I went to Nebraska, because I wanted to play baseball, and baseball was my first sport.
Very nice. Bob, questions for Johnny?
Yeah, Johnny, it's an honor to speak with you. I mean, when I was 10, 11, 12 years old, just getting into sports big time, you were the college football man, and I had some great memories watching you, and I want to thank you for that. And Chris mentioned earlier in the show, Johnny, they called you the Jet, and you had lightning speed a la your Rocket Ismail, guys like that. I think of guys like that when I think of yourself, and you were such a forerunner. When did you know, Johnny, that you were just a very fast human being and this could probably make you a good living?
Well, very early in life, like I said, I grew up in the poor parts, the eastern part the river bottoms here in Omaha, Nebraska. And my whole goal in life was to really get, from the time I was 10 years old, all I ever thought about was making $100,000. And I knew that playing some type of sport was really going to be the way. And as I said, Bob Gibson's brother, Josh Gibson, was my baseball coach. And I had really planned to play baseball because he was a big hero of mine. But I knew baseball or football was basically going to be my way out of the ghetto. And I thought more baseball than football. And I was pretty fast. I ran a 4.4 40, but I really didn't have blazing track speed. But I was able to maneuver and to fake along the way. So it was very, very elusive, more so than I would actually call fast. But there was a guy who is our sports commentator here at Nebraska named Lyle Brimser, who actually named me the Jet. And because he was calling the runs, he and I, in the game of the century, it became rather famous. And he said, "Johnny the Jet Rodgers just tore them loose from their shoes. Holy moly, man, woman, and child." And the name stuck. So that's how I actually got the name the Jet.
And you mentioned Coach Osborne. Johnny, I mean, he once called you the best punt returner he had ever seen. But as a coach, we've talked to many guys who played under him and just respected his preparation and everything else. I have to get your thoughts on Coach Osborne.
Well, Coach Osborne at that particular time was my position coach. He really was. He wasn't the head coach. He was the position coach, and then he went on to be the offensive coordinator. And then after my my senior year, he became head coach. But right. We worked together quite a bit. I learned quite a bit from him as far as my offensive skills are concerned and being able to read defenses. And he, Coach Fisher, Cletus Fisher, was my special teams coach. And Cletus is the guy who actually gave me the permission to no fair catch. I never really fair caught a punt return because I had a green light to do it. And that was pretty much Cletus Fisher's doing, more so than even Bob Devaney's, because Bob Devaney let his coaches coach make their own decisions. And so he gave me that latitude to be able to do it. Coach Osborne just called my plays being the offensive coordinator. He could call my plays whenever needed. And I didn't really get a lot of plays, but I got significant plays. And we scored on big plays quite often.
Sure did.
Johnny, one more before we let you go. I know you started the Johnny Rodgers Youth Foundation. Talk about what your foundation does.
Well, actually, I have a foundation, and I raise money for kids to go into the trades. And I've created an award called the Jet Award. I looked around 4 or 5 years ago now, and I noticed that the only category in college football that didn't have a trophy attached to it was the special teams, with the punt returns and kickoff guys. And so being one of the leaders in punt returns and kickoffs in the history of college football, I started an award, and they called it the Johnny the Jet Rodgers National College Football Return Specialist Award. And in short, we've named it the Jet Award. And what we do is pick the best college punt return and kickoff guy in the country, and we're in our fifth year now. And I use that to raise money for kids to go to school and to get an education in the trades, because I believe that the fastest way to get back into the middle class is through the trades. I came from a trade school. The street that they're naming after me here in July is right next to my former high school, where almost all of my friends had skills in the trades. And because of that, they were all self-sufficient. And because their parents were in the trades, and so because everybody had jobs and fairly decent jobs, we didn't have widespread crime. You could be poor, but you didn't necessarily have to be dirt poor like they are today. Today, currently here in Omaha, Nebraska, our adults are number one in poverty in the whole United States. And the children are number three in poverty in the whole United States. And we live in a state that's got more millionaires per capita than any place else in the country. And a lot of that has to do with closing down Technical High School, which was the school that I went to. And so there's no more opportunities for kids to get the educations and the trades. So Metro Community College has started a great program in the trades. They have 50 different trades you can actually get into, and you can earn money while you learn to get your education. And so that's been the alternative. And so we've created that scholarship fund to send those kids to school. Every year I can give $1,000 to a kid and a Pell Grant and allow them to go to school for a whole year. And they don't have to take out any student loans to become in debt. Like a lot of kids are going to school and they're actually becoming getting in debt more so than they're getting education.
Well, that's a great thing you're doing, Johnny. Thank you very much for that. And Johnny, thank you for taking time out of your night to be a part of the show. We'll hope you come back and join us again sometime. So much more to get into with you about your career. We'd love to have you come back sometime. We hope you'll join us.
All right. Well, that's great. I would just like to point out, too, that the significance of my first story when I told you that Mike Garrett was the second Heisman Trophy, when Ernie Davis was the first Black American to win the Heisman. Mike Garrett was the second. O.J. was the third. And because my father had brought that up and put it in my mind, I became the fourth African American to win the Heisman Trophy. Also, my very first contract, I was able to get that $100,000 that I had been after ever since I was 10 years old. And I actually end up winning a national championship and the Heisman Trophy at the same time. So all those goals that I set at an early age actually just came true.
That's fantastic stuff. Johnny, thank you so much for being a part of the show. We look forward to catching up with you real soon. In between now and then, all the best to you and your family.
All right, fellas. Thank you very much. Anytime. My pleasure.
All right. Take care, Johnny. Johnny Rodgers. Great stuff. I mean, just so much stuff to get into, Bob. Unfortunately, we didn't have enough time to get into it all, but what an amazing college and early part of his pro career that Johnny had.
We'll have to get him back, Chris. We didn't really touch the surface because of time constraints, but you're right. I mean, he was the first guy I remember that was just electric on a football field. I would just tell people to go and try to see some of the 1973 Orange Bowl highlights. I think he caught a few touchdown passes. He ran for a few and even threw one, Chris. He was, like you said, very elusive, and what a pleasure to watch play football.
Absolutely right. All right, now joining us on the Kyven Foods guest line is our very first guest that we ever had on this show, and that's Mr. Levon Kirkland. Let me remind you about Levon's background. He's from Lamar, South Carolina, played his college ball at Clemson, where he was a consensus All-American in 1991. He is also a member of their All-Century team and was inducted into their Hall of Fame in 2001. He was also inducted into the South Carolina Athletic Hall of Fame in 2008. He was a second-round draft pick by the Steelers in 1992 and played in the NFL from 92 to 2002, all but two of those seasons being with the Steelers. He spent 1 year each in Seattle and Philadelphia. He was selected to the Pro Bowl in back-to-back years in 1996 and 97, was named to the 1990s All-Decade Team. He recently spent a couple of seasons as a defensive coordinator for Florida A&M, and we are thrilled that, A, he was patient with us, and, B, that he is back with us tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Levon, Chris, and Bob, thanks for joining us.
Hey, what's up, Chris and Bob? How are you guys doing?
I'm good. How are you, Levon?
I'm doing excellent. Doing well. Thank you.
Great.
So, Levon, I'm curious, this time of year, you know, we've had OTAs going on, mini camps going on. You've got training camp just a few weeks ahead of us. So, you know, training camp, when all of that sort of stuff came along when you were playing, is that something you look forward to? Or is, you know, I'm sort of imagining it like, you know, school let out and you're having it's summertime. And then all of a sudden, now you got schools back in session. It wasn't always the time we always look forward to as kids. Was that, were you looking forward to training camp, or was it, you know, God, man, all right, time to get back to it?
In ways, I did look forward to training camp because I got back to doing what I loved doing. But, you know, sometimes when I'm like, man, I'll be glad this is over with. I mean, I didn't like mini camp as much as I like training camp. Training camp was okay, you know, it's just you got a chance to bond with the guys that you're playing with, and you kind of was deep into what you love doing. Mini camp was a little tough for me because you get to go home and you have to come back. And at that time, we were doing like tour days, and it was just it just kind of dragged on for me. But, you know, I was up in Arizona helping them with their mini camp as a coach. And, you know, I really enjoyed it. I really did enjoy it. You realize that, you know, it's a privilege and honor to be a part of the NFL, that, you know, guys have an opportunity at this point in time to really do something they love, that, you know, they can really help their families financially. And, you know, I would tell anybody, just take advantage of that opportunity. So, but back in my day, I liked training camp. I just didn't like mini camp.
So you say out in Arizona, were you out there, starting to help coach with the Cardinals?
Yeah. I was out there, helping with their inside backers and outside backers. So it was a lot of fun. I go back on July 26th for their training camp, and looking forward to it.
Will we see you on the Cardinals sideline during the season?
I mean, you never know. Well, we'll see what happens.
All right. So, you know, building out the sort of the training camp and the camp ideas, the OTAs and all that sort of stuff, July, you guys are out there, it's hot. You know, I'm imagining, once you get a few days in, tempers start to flare a little bit. What's it like, when you've just sort of had enough? Were there fisticuffs going on at certain points? And were you involved in that? Or are you the guy pulling everybody off?
You know what? I just didn't believe in fighting in practice because I was the kind of guy who liked to conserve his energy for the right thing. And I just thought fighting back then was kind of foolish. But, yeah, we had some fights. And I probably was involved in maybe one fight just because the guy pushed me in my back. And everybody who knows me knows that's my pet peeve. And if you push my back, that turns another button up. But, yeah, I kind of was a guy who kind of, when people started fighting, I just kind of sat back and kind of looked at it. But, back then, it's not like they're going to pull you out of practice. You're going to still practice. And most likely you're going to go the next rep. So now you're tired. And you still got to keep practicing. So to me, right, fighting, especially if you got helmets on, shoulder pads, I mean, really, what kind of effect are your punches going to really have? So I kind of tend to stay out of those kind of things. And plus, I broke my wrist when I was a rookie, not because I was fighting, but, I just didn't want to get involved. So I kind of stayed away from fighting. But it was kind of fun watching other guys fight. It was kind of fun watching those guys do it.
So, Levon, I'm curious, when you came into the league as a rookie, did guys embrace you and help you learn? Steelers defense is, complicated. We see, a lot of guys, taking, a couple of years to get the opportunity to start. We see that on some of the Steelers nowadays. You started right away. Did guys take you under their wing to help you, or were they not so helpful because they know you're coming in there to take their job?
They were not so helpful. it was just a different – it's a different era. It was, you came in, those guys wanted to keep their job. And I was, I was drafted in the second round. The writing was on the wall. And, they didn't really take to me right away. I can tell you a quick story if
sure.
I can.
Yeah.
My second year, my first year I didn't start at all. I was just a special team guy. But I was just, I was also a guy who played outside backer, and they moved me to the inside. So it took me really about a year to kind of learn it and, just kind of getting some repetition at it. Second year I was, vying for the starting job. And the first game, David Little actually started the preseason game. The next game, I was a preseason starter. And there was the Steelers Digest at the time had a cover story of me about the man in the middle. So we had a meeting on Monday after the preseason game, which was kind of unusual at the time. Coach Kyle gets up there and he tells everybody that they released David Little. All eyes came on me. I mean, they just looked at me. I got out, and you know, reporters were just like, "How do you feel about being a starter?" And we still had practice to go. So really, this is my first initial time with the starters. So you got guys who are veterans, and at that time we had a mixture of guys who were pretty young, like Joe Steve, Dan Perry, you know, myself. You know, we were young guys, and then you had guys who were older guys. So I'm in front of the huddle. Now I got to take control of the huddle with guys like Rod Woodson and guys like Craig Floyd. You know, David was their boy. So, man, that it was tough back then. You had to really kind of earn your respect. You had to, you know, once they knew that they can count on you and that you can play and you're a player, then you kind of got accepted in the fold. And that's what really kind of happened to me. But I wasn't embraced at first, especially when I took David Little's job. But I have to say, guys like Kevin Green, guys like Jerry Osvosky, those were the guys who kind of put me under their wing and just kind of really helped me as far as my development of the game. But the other guys, it took a little while for them to catch on.
It took a while to come around.
It took them a little second to come around, especially when you're the signal caller and they're just like ignoring everything you say. They're telling you to make the call and turn around, make the call. And, you know, Coach Kyle told me, you know, he's like, listen, you know, we got you in the spot. You're going to have to be a little bit more forceful. So I learned how to be a little bit forceful and take control of the huddle, but it still was difficult with some of the guys we had.
Which wasn't your personality, right? You weren't the outgoing, take charge guy,
no.
Right?
See, that's the thing. You know, I am really an introvert. I mean, I can talk and I can get along with people. I can carry on conversations. You know, I can do speaking engagements. I mean, you know, if you would see me out, you would never think that. But for the most part, you know, I didn't really hang out. Didn't have a lot of close friends on the team. I'm actually kind of a guy that's to himself, really. You know, I'm really still kind of that way. So, but yeah, it forced me to kind of come out of my shell a little bit. Because at Clemson and playing outside linebacker, you know, I didn't have to make the calls. I'm just sacking the quarterback. But at Pittsburgh, man, especially playing that position, you had to kind of come out a little bit more. And I did. It actually did kind of help my personality. You know, I'm a naturally funny guy, but man, it was really something that I had to work on. You know,
and that's something that not everyone knows about you. You're hilarious. Right. If you go out to YouTube and look up Levon Kirkland, there's a lot of funny stuff out there.
You know, you know what? Everybody tells me that. Everybody's just like, man, you are so funny. I mean, I even remember Greg Lloyd the other day. He's just like, you just got this brand of humor. It's kind of a sneaky sense of humor. But if you get me in a crowd, I can work it. And, you know, even during camp, I would do stuff that would even crack up Coach Carr, you know. So, but if you would see me playing ball, you would never think that. You would never think that I had this other humorous side. But, you know, once people got to meet me and got to know me, they kind of actually saw that humorous side. So it's kind of funny that, you know, most people tend to think that I'm more intimidating, that I'm some kind of, you know, mean guy, but in all honesty, I'm not.
There you go. Bob, questions for Levon?
Levon, I think Chris will agree. You weren't funny to opposing running backs and quarterbacks at times, so you knew when to do your thing, I guess. So.
Yeah, you know, I had a split personality.
Yeah, you have to, right, to play the game. And
you really have man, to, yes.
And, you know, Levon, what always impressed me about yourself, when I thought of linebackers back in that day, you know, you think of guys that had height, and maybe 6'3 guys that played at around 250. You were more, and take this as a compliment, you were more of the bulldog type. You were like a 6'1, 270 player who could run. And at that size, Levon, it is hard to keep up that kind of speed. Is your speed something that you constantly worked on, or was it a natural gift?
You know, honestly, I was more quick than fast. I didn't have a great 40 time, but one of the things that I was extremely quick for my size. Like, my feet were very light. I can maneuver well. And I really did a good job of understanding angles of the game. I knew where people were going to be. I knew how to cover. I knew how to take things on. So, you know, I wasn't extremely fast. I was just extremely quick. And, you know, I just had, you know, I think what Emmitt Smith has is just competitive speed. You know, if you line me up against a guy and we racing, I'm going to, even if he's, like, faster, I'm going to stick with him. I mean, and I had to cover a lot of guys downfield. So I was just really competitive. I just didn't like getting beat. I just wanted to get beat deep. So I ran my butt off. I was just running scared half the time. But it was something that came natural. And, you know, I didn't particularly work on it. But I was a guy who did a lot of ropes. You know, a lot of ropes. Just really good at agility stuff. I mean, the bag drills, you know, it's amazing. I mean, guys would look at me and like, I can't believe you can move that fast. It was just something that was just always there. I really didn't work on it like probably athletes today. A lot of guys really work on their speed and their takeoff. I really didn't do that. It just kind of came naturally to me.
And what also stands out to me, Levon, is your durability. And you just never miss games. And I think it has something to do with what you said about once you get a job, you don't want to lose it. But then again, you had to work hard in the off season. You had to be blessed genetically. There had to be a lot of things going into to not missing games like you did.
You know, the people would look at my size, but, I was the kind of guy who worked out twice a day during off season. You know, I would work out in the mornings, then I would come out in the afternoon. I did boxing. I did different things. I was always pretty much a durable guy. So, you know, I never missed a game. You know, from high school to college to pros, I never missed a game. So, you know, that's a lot of being blessed and, you know, my father praying for me. But also just, you know, kind of genetics. You know, I'm a thicker guy, which I think really kind of helps as far as football is concerned. Had great legs, so never, you know, knees or anything like that never really got to me. So, you know, it's a combination of good fortune, being blessed, right genetics, whatever you want to say. I mean, it's just it's real fortunate to play that long and not get injuries. But I worked. You know, I think that's what a lot of people didn't understand. For me to be that big, I really did work pretty hard, and was really consistent, I think, as a football player.
Levon, I want to get your opinion on what you think we'll see from the Steelers this year. You know, Kevin Butler taking over as the D coordinator. Do you expect to see the Steelers do, you know, a lot of different things, or do you think it's just going to be some minor little wrinkles that Butler will do with the defensive scheme?
You know, I think Butts is a great, great coach, to be honest with you. I think he's going to really remain the same, but I think he's going to definitely add his own wrinkles to it. I think most defensive coordinators, they want to make sure that everybody understands, or anybody who takes over, that they're going to put their stamp on it. But I think he's not going to do something, I don't think, foolish. I think he has the respect of the players. I think they definitely will follow him. I mean, he's following, it's a tough act to follow. But I think he's a guy that can get the job done. And, you know, it's always a combination of scheme and, you know, getting the right players, you know, getting those players, you know, getting the skill set that they need to get in there. And then also everybody buying into it, you know. And that's the thing that I think he's going to have to really get. You know, you can run the same defense, but if guys don't really buy into you, then it's tougher. You know, it's just tough. You know, they're not going to listen. They're going to kind of, especially guys who've been there, they're going to be kind of stubborn about it. But, you know, the good thing is I think Butts has been there. He understands the defense. He's going to probably run some things very similar. You know, he's going to keep some things the same. But, you know, he's going to add his twist to it, his personality. And I think the defense will do fine. I really do. I think that the good thing about it is the Steelers have always been based on defense, and that's really what the people of Pittsburgh want to see. They want to see great defense. I'm sure they appreciate the offense, but, you know, that place is always built on having great defenses, especially having great linebackers, and I'm sure they're going to get back to that. I really believe that.
So when you talk about, you know, the linebacking core, and you are one of four guys that are, you know, going to go down as Steelers lore as, you know, probably one of the great linebacking cores in NFL history, certainly right up there with the guys from the 70s, you know, you, Kevin Green, Greg Lloyd, Chad Brown, who's a great friend of the show. When you look at, you know, what the Steelers have now at linebacker, potentially, depending on, you know, how quickly Bud Dupree gets up to speed, they could have four former number one picks out there on that linebacking core. What do you make of, what's your assessment of those four guys? And I know Bud Dupree is young to see, so maybe just the returning three in Shazier and Timmons and then in Jarvis Jones.
Well, you know, I think it's a work in progress. We, you know, just have to see those guys play and see those guys gel. I talked to some guys and they asked me about, you know, what was the deal between, you know, with the linebacker core? What made us special?
Did we lose you?
We had to play up to Greg and Kevin's level, and we didn't want to, you know, be the weak links. So it was accountability, and it was an attitude. We all were pretty competitive. We knew we all brought something different to the table, but it worked. But the main thing is we had an attitude about the game. We wanted to be the best at it, and we were accountable. We watched film together as the practice was over with. I mean, we would quiz each other. I mean, we really did take pride in being the best linebacker core in the NFL at that time. So, you know, it's a combination of things. And those guys have to really, you know, especially I think the inside backers, man, they almost have to be, God, like partners, like joining the hip. And that was the thing that me and Chad was. We were really great partners. We worked really well together. And we knew, we kind of knew each other's strengths and weaknesses. And, you know, we just kind of encouraged each other and played on that. And we realized that we were the younger guys and that we had, you know, we were the harder defense and we had to bring it every game. But Greg Lord and Kevin, man, they had such a standard of how they play that it helped us lift our game up. So basically those guys are going to have to really lift each other up. They're going to have to be brothers, and they're going to have to really take pride in what they're doing. And if they do that and they work with each other, they're going to be good. Now, if they don't, then, you know, they won't be as good. But in that 3-4 defense, man, those linebackers are crucial, very important. So those guys need to step their game up a notch, and they really need to play off each other. So if they can do that, have an attitude about it, they're going to be fine.
Bob, one more for Levon before we let him go.
Did I break that? Did I break that down enough? Did I break it down?
You did a great job, Levon. That's fantastic. Thank you.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Levon, last one for me. I know the game is a business, and you ended up playing 9 of your 11 years in Pittsburgh and ending up in Seattle, Philadelphia, which were two pretty good teams. But what was it like? Was it very hard to leave Pittsburgh, Levon, where you really were beloved and basically where you made your name? How tough was it? Or did you just have to treat it as, hey, this is my job, and I played ages 32 and 33. I'm still an NFL player.
You know, honestly, I'm being truthful with you. It hurt when I got released because I was a Steelers soldier. I was. You know, that's the only place I played for 9 years. So I was willing to take a pay cut to stay with the Steelers, you know. I didn't want to leave. I didn't. And I knew that team was going to be really good next year. I even said it. When we didn't make the playoffs, we were playing San Diego. I got all the guys together. I'm saying, let's get ready for next year because next year's going to be special. We're gonna dominate next year. And Pitt, I was perfect. They did. So it was hard because I knew how good that team was going to be, and I knew how successful it was going to be. And they got right up to the point where they were the favorites to win the whole thing. They were playing so great. And, you know, they end up not winning that game. But it was hard for me at first. And then, you know, once you kind of analyze it, and I talked to Mr. Rooney, I talked to Coach Kyle. And, you know, really, after I got out of being, you know, once it stopped being personal and I understood that part of it, and I knew I gave everything I had for the team, I didn't take it personally. You know, I didn't go in there slamming in the doors or flipping over tables or telling that I hate the Steelers. I told Mr. Rooney, thank you for the opportunity. You know, thank you guys for getting a guy who was kind of a tweener and believing in me enough to draft me in the second round. And, you know, I got redid a couple of times before I really went to free agent. So, I mean, they believed in me enough that they kept me around for a very long time. I wanted to play there forever if I could have. But, you know, it's a special place. And, you know, I tell anybody, I think once you're a Steeler, you're kind of a Steeler, you know. So, yeah, it was tough at first. But, you know, I got over it, and I became emotionally intelligent about the whole thing, and I realized that it was a business. And, you know, it definitely helped me as I went along to the other teams, because I knew that, you know, it was a business, and, you know, you can't get too caught up. And I think it kind of released me a little bit. I could, you know, I didn't have to worry about, you know, am I playing well all the time? You know, with the Steelers, man, I was the only linebacker left. And you're trying to hold that standard, and you realize it's not, you know, it's got to be about the team. Everybody else has got to get better. And I felt that we're going to, you know, that year we're going to get better, but, you know, I wasn't around to see that year. I knew eventually that the Steelers would win the Super Bowl under Coach Kyle. I just wanted to be there. But, you know, it all in all, great experience, man. I couldn't ask to go to a better place. I mean, I really couldn't. I mean, special place, special people. Special organizations, and when it's that good, it's just kind of hard to go anywhere else. And, you know, I went to Seattle and Philly, and they weren't bad places to go, but for me, it wasn't quite the Steeler experience.
Levon, one more before we let you go. And you talked about your partner, Chad Brown, and we've had Chad on the show a number of times as well. So I got to ask you, what's your favorite Chad Brown story?
My favorite Chad Brown story? Gosh. You know, Chad was kind of funny. Chad was kind of quiet. You know, he was a married guy. He was a single guy. So, honestly, we just had a great working relationship. But, you know, we didn't really go out that much or hang out. But I tell you, we were playing the Colts. And we both just made the Pro Bowl for our very first time. And I remember him having one of the best days I ever see him have. And it got to a point where he was like, you know, we were running stunts. And usually when we ran stunts, I would go first. He would kind of come behind, more of a cleanup guy. And I think he felt kind of bad. And he was like, man, do you want me to go first? One of these stunts. I'm like, nah, man, hey, I'm the enforcer. You're the cleanup guy. It's just how it is. So, you know, don't worry about it. I mean, but I do remember him being kind of clumsy. It was kind of funny.
Is that right?
He was one of the, yeah, you couldn't block him now. Like, he was one of the tougher guys to block. But, man, just walking around, he would just trip, just fly. Like, how can you be so athletic and so clumsy at the same time? So that was the kind of thing we kind of teasing with a little bit, like, you're athletic. You can't, but it was hard to block Chad Brown. He just had this, he could move in ways. He was very flexible, and he could just really move his body. And, I mean, Snake was a great name for him because he could just move around. I mean, he really could. But, man, on a regular basis, and this dude would trip. This dude would fall. He would fall all the time. You're like, what in the hell is going on with this dude? But he was definitely I think, honestly, if we would have played together longer, man, we'd have done some phenomenal days. I mean, as a young group, man, we were special. I'm just talking about me and him. I mean, what we did at the age that we were, people don't realize how young we were when we played.
Right.
And started. So Yeah, so, Chad's my guy. He's one of my favorite guys.
I just got a text message from Randy Fuller, and he texted me. He said, ask LeVon about Randy Fuller.
You know what, man? Randy Fuller, man, saved us in the Super Bowl. But the great thing about Randy Rand was he was one of, like, you have guys on your team that you just like them on your team. Like, you know, good player, but you just love him on your team. He was the funniest guy. And we would do this thing. Like, we had these lockers, and we would do this game where we would dunk on each other. Like, you know, like the your locker was the basketball rim, and right. We would, like, dunk on each other. And I don't know why it was so hilarious, but it was. So we would do that all the time. Like, you know, somebody would throw an alley-oop, and you just dunk on somebody in their locker. And that was – I don't know why that was, but it was a game that I started. It just caught on like wildfire. So everybody used to dunk on each other in the in the locker room. It was stupid. It was silly because it got hurt, but it was our game. So I remember Randy just doing it to me all the time, just slamming, you know, just slamming the ball on me. It was kind of like getting a poster shot. So you got to do something in the locker room. You really, to get out of the boredom sometimes or just the grind, you got to do something fun. You got to let yourself have a little fun. And I thought that as serious as we were in the football field, man, we were very loose. And I think that helped us become a really good team. Man, we did a lot of things together, but Randy Rand, what time for the Randy Rand? That's what we always say about Randy.
That's great. LeVon, thank you so much for being generous with your time tonight. You're fantastic. We always have so much fun when you're a part of the show. Yeah. Thanks for coming back here. We hope you'll come back again.
I will. Thank you very much for having me.
All right. Take care, LeVon. We look forward to catching up with you again real soon.
All right.
Take care, LeVon.
LeVon Kirkland, and that is one of the things about LeVon, like we touched on in the interview, Bob. He is hilarious. When you talk to LeVon and you look him up on YouTube, the guy is absolutely hilarious to watch and listen to.
He is one of the more pleasant guys we ever get to speak with, Chris. Not just because he's such a down-to-earth, pleasant man, and has so many stories in the Pittsburgh lore and played with so many great players, but just as a human being, very few people have the personality to combine everything he does with a little smile to it. And we could all learn a lot from LeVon. Great guy.
Yeah, absolutely right. All right, we are going to get to our next guest, Dan Pastorini, on the other side of this station identification.
This is Christine Lisi, and you're listening to Thursday Night Tailgate, where NFL stars go to tell their stories with Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari on the Armed Forces Radio Network.
Now back with us on the Kyven Foods guest line is former Houston Oilers Pro Bowl quarterback Dan Pastorini. Let me remind you about Dan's background. He's from San Francisco, California, played his college ball at Santa Clara. He was a first-round draft pick, the number 3 overall selection in 1971 by the Houston Oilers. He played in the NFL from 71 to 1983 with the Oilers, Raiders, Rams, and Eagles. Was selected to the Pro Bowl in 1975. Over the course of his career, he threw for 18,515 yards and 103 touchdowns and ran for nearly 700 more yards and 8 touchdowns. And let's not forget, as Bob pointed out in the intro to the show, he punted 316 times for over 12,500 yards and had a long of 74 yards. He's become a great friend of the show, and we are so excited when we get to have him as part of Thursday Night Tailgate, and we get to have him back tonight. Hey, Dan, Chris, and Bob, how are you, my friend?
Hey, guys. I'm doing great. How you doing?
Oh, very good. Thank you.
Good.
So, Dan, I'm curious to know, you know, when you played in the city of Houston for 9 years and spent most of your time in the NFL with the Oilers, but now, you know, the franchise has moved. It's now the Tennessee Titans. Is your allegiance still to the, you know, the city of Houston and the Texans, or are you more a part of, you know, the Titans?
Well, I'm a Houstonian first. So that being said, we're going to support the team that's here in Houston. However, you know, when you play a career and, you know, I have friends, Lynn Dickey, for instance, that played for the traditional team of Green Bay in Green Bay, Wisconsin, the Green Bay Packers, or Mike Ditka from the Chicago Bears. And I was explaining to them recently that, you know, you guys have something that's part of a legacy, and you're part of something. You're part of history of the game. And unfortunately, the Oiler name is gone, and the association with the Oilers is gone, except for the city here that remembers the Love You Blue years in 78, 79 when we had our success. And, you know, it's a shame because we're kind of an anomaly. We're not associated with the Texans at all, and other than the fact we live here in the city, but we really have nothing to do with the franchise or the team or the players. And yet, you know, the Oilers / Titans have moved to Tennessee, and, you know, we really don't have an affiliation with the Titans. And in all the years since they've been gone, I've never, ever been invited to come to Tennessee for anything. Wow. So it's really kind of a sad situation. We're former Oilers, but we're kind of a trivia question. You know, a lot of people in this day and age, you know, youngsters especially, they don't know who the heck the Oilers were, you know, or are. You know, we do. The memories, as Bum always said, the memories can't die. And, you know, the guys that we played with, they're all very close to this day. And like you said, you can't take the memories away. So that's a blessing in itself.
Do the Texans organization, you know, embrace you guys? Have they invited you guys to be a part of what's going on, you know, from a, you know, whether it's their franchise or the city's perspective, to have you guys be a part of, you know, what, you know, their, whether it's, you know, celebrations that they have, or just have you, you know, try to embrace you guys as, you know, former Houstonian players?
Well, actually, there are some players that are what they call ambassadors for the team. And, you know, they'll show up on Sundays and, you know, hang around and sign autographs and whatnot. And, you know, that's kind of the only association that we have. And, you know, it's fine, but a lot of us have other things to do and a lot more important things to do, or careers and jobs that we have to pay attention to. So a lot of us don't have the time to do it. But, you know, it's not like the other cities, I would say. So it's a lot different. They do it as a courtesy, which I'll give them credit for. You know, they're pretty nice about that. I mean, since Bill O'Brien's been here, I've yet to go over to one of the practices and meet him. I've had the chance to meet Romy Cornell, nice guy. What I see of Bill O'Brien seems to be a top-notch guy. I would love to meet him sometime, but again, I don't have the time to go over to the practice field. I've got a business I've got to run. So hey, let's take precedence, you know?
Yeah, no, absolutely. So, Dan, I want to talk about, you know, being a number one draft pick, and talk about the difficulties and the expectations of being a number one pick, you know, particularly if you're a quarterback, and, you know, going through all the losing that you guys did, you know, very on in, you know, your first 3 years in the league. What was it like dealing with the pressure from, you know, the media and you know, down in Houston, and, you know, just even the national media, and being a number one guy and the expectations that were placed on you? How'd you deal with, you know, trying to, you know, make your way in the league, particularly when the guys around you or the franchise around you struggled so hard?
Well, you know, that was the frustrating part of it. I think if I'd have signed out of high school to play with the New York Mets, I think I'd have had a better career. But I think that, you know, the transition down here to the game and the, you know, the South and the city and whatnot, the biggest thing was the number of coaches. I mean, we went through four or five coaches in the first 5 years. And, you know, when Sid Gilman came in 19, actually took over for Bill Peterson in 73, and then ran the team in 74. And then 75, we had some respectability. We had some, you know, we had a coach that hung around for a couple of years, and then he was gone. And then Bum Phillips took over in 1975. And to be honest with you, I didn't really know who Bum Phillips was. I knew he was our defensive coordinator, and our defense was playing pretty well. So, you know, that was a credit to him. But, you know, I didn't know what kind of coach the guy would be. And, you know, lo and behold, he turned out to be the greatest coach I ever played for, and had the pleasure of playing with him for, you know, 5 years. And, you know, he really turned the team around. He turned the city around. And for once, we finally got some stability. We got some decent players in. And, you know, the game changed for us. We started winning a little bit more, not as much as we liked, but you know, we had opportunities in 1978 and 79 in championship games against Pittsburgh, but, you know, we had to play the Pittsburgh Steelers to go, you know, to the Super Bowl, and those aren't the easiest guys to play to go to the Super Bowl. And, you know, fortunately, they went on to win the Super Bowls both years, but it sure would have been nice to be able to fulfill that dream and go to the Super Bowl.
Bob, questions for Dan?
Yes, Dan, you know, we've always heard your name in the same breath with Archie Manning. Since you guys were pretty much the same age, same draft, you were 2-3 that year, both went to bad teams, both kind of took a beating at the time. I was just wondering, Dan, if you guys ever hooked up and shared some old stories together, how well do you know Archie?
I know Archie pretty well. In fact, our first few years in the league, we kind of hung out together, I guess, at the same functions. We were invited to a lot of the same functions. And during the Super Bowls down there, I would visit him, and he'd kind of show me around the city of New Orleans, which was nice. I remember seeing, you know, Peyton and Cooper and Eli as little kids, and, you know, and kind of, I mean, they were like 2 and 3 years old. And, you know, to see the family and those kids do as well as they have, it's really kind of a fun thing to watch. But no, Archie and I have always been pretty good friends. We never, you know, we've stayed in touch a little bit over the years. But, you know, like I say, as your years go by, your careers and your friends kind of fall apart a little bit, and distance grows a little more, and you don't really stay in touch as much. But, you know, we get an opportunity to see each other maybe once every 3 or 4 years, and that's good. You know, he's a great guy, great family, and he was a great, tremendous, you know, asset to the game. There's no question about that. He certainly has done well raising kids to play the game, that's for sure.
Yeah, good genes, right?
Yeah, excellent genes. You know, I told him one time, I said, you know, they ought to put you out the stud.
And I think the last time we talked, Dan, I told you how much my father enjoyed watching. I think, first of all, he always called you Dante Pastorini, being the Italian that he was. And my father just loved players who were multi-dimensional. His favorite player of all time probably was Paul Hornung, who could do things, you know, both on and off the field incredibly. But as far as, you know, being just such a great athlete, and which brings me, and I mentioned it to Chris before, your punting, was it something that you've done since you were very young, or did it become something out of necessity during your football career?
No, it was actually something I'd always done. I always punted. I kicked off. I kicked field goals. I kicked extra points. In fact, one time in college for a few games, one of our guys who was the holder broke his finger, and nobody could take the snap and hold the ball. And I told my coach, well, I can drop kick it. So I drop kicked extra points and field goals for a while. So, you know, it was just something I always did, and it was kind of a blessing and familiar to me as throwing was. You know, it just came natural. And, you know, I figured the more things you can do, the longer you hang around. So I was willing to punt, kick, whatever it took.
Dan, you were one of the toughest quarterbacks of all time. You played through so many injuries, namely some broken ribs, a punctured lung, and you were also the first guy to wear a flak jacket. Talk about, you know, how the flak jacket came to be and how they actually got you to wear one.
Well, it was a very strange situation. We played Pittsburgh, and I took a hit on the rear side, right side, right in the middle of the back, and broke two ribs and fractured a third rib, and was laying in the hospital, and this guy comes walking through the door, knocks on the door of my hospital room, and he sticks his head in, and he says, Mr. Pastorini. Yes. So this guy slides through the door with a buddy of his, and his buddy's carrying a baseball bat, and he's carrying a bag. So I don't know what's going on. I'm so sore I can't reach the buzzer to get the nurse in there. I thought these guys were going to bet the ranch in the game and lost, and they were going to pummel me to death and carry me out in the sack. So he reaches into this sack and he puts it up against his rib cage, not saying a word, you know, just kind of looking at me, and I'm looking at him and just kind of figuring what's going on here. And his buddy grabs the bat and whacks him about 3 times as hard as he could in the ribs where he had this protective pad. So I finally got the gist of the reason for his calling on me. And I said, I'd like to have one of those. I said, okay. And he runs out of the room. And so this was like Sunday, and I went over to the locker room on Tuesday, I think it was, and he showed up with this prototype, which was made from a Navy SEAL life vest. And I don't know if you've ever seen a Navy SEAL life vest, but they're very thin, and they have very small air passages throughout the vest. And he had this piece of Kevlar with a little foam around it and kind of taped to the vest. And so we tried it on, and his friend, you know, hit me with the baseball bat, and it worked pretty good. You know, I said, well, great, you know, we'll try it. And that's how it came about, and I wore it for the rest of the season. I think it was like 3 or 4 games to the end of the season. Then we had the 3 playoff games, and it worked very well. So after that, he had a line of, padding for football for many, many years. And I think at one time, every pro team, every college team, and high school team in the United States was using his pads. He also promised me 10% of the company. I'm still waiting for that check. I never quite got that. No, one of those deals. But, it worked. It worked very well. And, that was kind of my contribution to the game to protect the quarterbacks nowadays. Of course, nowadays they don't get hit that much, so they really don't need flag jackets.
Dan, after your playing days, you got heavily into drag racing. You actually beat Big Daddy Don Garlitz in drag racing. Did that, you know, from a transition, we hear so many times, you know, Dan, about guys who struggle with depression after their playing days because they don't know what to do next, and, you know, the competition piece is gone. And did that transition over to drag racing help replace, you know, the competition that you were putting behind in your NFL career and kind of fill that void or gap for you?
Actually, yes, in a way it did, because the depression I was going through was kind of hanging around the last 3 years. I was going through a battle with Al Davis, well-documented, over contract disputes, and wound up being a very frustrating and very depressing time in my life. And, you know, you spring into action, and, you know, your survivalist mode takes over, and you say, well, I've got to do something. And the only thing I could think of I really wanted to do was to go racing. I was and am today a big racing fan. I don't care what kind of racing it is, car racing, I'll watch it. And just so happened that I had more experience in drag racing and had a lot of friends in drag racing to help me get into it. Raymond Beadle with the Blue Max, and Don Prudhomme, and Kenny Bernstein. You know, I'd followed these guys for many years during my playing career. And Raymond Beadle was the most influential, as well as Linda Vaughn. Linda helped me and get introduced to the right people to get us on track. And it was a passion I've had for many, many years. And again, that's a sport that takes a lot of money and takes, you know, hiring the right people. And, you know, driving the cars is one thing, but you have to have a team and a crew that can, you know, haul the rig around the country and can do the bottom end and can do the top end and can tune the car and make it work. You know, you had to kind of stay ahead of the game. And that took quite a bit of money. And we struggled for a while. We actually went around the country touring in what they called the match racing series. So we'd run a national event, say, in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, and we'd come over to Texas and run in Houston that next weekend and get paid for it. And then we'd run in Dallas and get paid for it. And we might go to San Antonio, get paid for it, and make our way to Phoenix and go race the national event there. And then work our way around the country to the next race. It was kind of barnstorming a little bit. But, you know, we made money by, they'd show us, give us show up money. And, you know, you'd sell t-shirts. And we had a good following, a good fan base, and that really kept us supported. And I miss the sport. I really, I enjoyed my time in it. There are many fans today that contact me on Facebook, and they have a lot of remembrances. They post a lot of pictures. And it's really kind of fun to see how many people remembered us. And it was a pleasure competing in that sport. You know, it's, you know, you're just like football. I played against Johnny Unitas and Bart Starr and their teams, and here I'm running against Shirley Muldowney and Don Garlitz. You know, it was quite a fun time and fun experience. But, you know, we were able to win one national event, the Southern Nationals. I think it was in 1985 or 86, I think it was. And that was really a big thrill. We really were out of money. and had no more money. And my friend Larry Andrew here in Baytown, Texas, said, "I've got a good feeling about this. Go race." And he gave me a check, gave me $10,000 to go do it. And we won the race and ultimately signed Coors Light to a 3-year contract after that, which helped us survive. Unfortunately, it wasn't quite the money we needed, but it kept us out there. And it was fun. You know, I enjoyed the sport and I enjoyed the fans and the competitors. Everybody was kind of one big family. And even today, and when they came here to Houston, I brought some friends of mine in the Deacons of Deadwood motorcycle group that I'm involved with, which some of them never seen a drag race before. And Bob Vandegrift was very kind in receiving us over to his hospitality area. And he thought I took these guys, a bunch of kids to a candy store. And they were really enthralled with the machinery and the power of the cars and the speeds and everything else. And it was fun. It was fun sharing that with them.
That's a great story.
You know, it kept me sane, and it's, you gotta live life and do things that you're passionate about. And I was able to do that for quite a few years, and then you move on to do other things.
Dan, just one more before we let you go. We've got our next guest, Carey Davis, hanging on the line. We're going to get to Carey in just a moment. You mentioned, at the top of the interview about, running a business. You've got a business to run. Talk about, remind our listeners, about your company and how they can, check it out online and then follow both you and the company over social media.
Well, we've got a company called Dan Pastorini's Quality Foods. And we have three spices that we've been marketing for the last 3 years. It's a very small company. We've got, we're on Facebook at danpastorinequalityfoods.com or Dan Pastorini Quality Foods. And then we also have a website at dpqualityfoods.com. And you can order our products online. We're primarily here in Texas. We have a few stores in California. It's it's a small startup company, but we're hanging in there. We're trying to make it grow, and it's been a challenge to say the least. Very competitive business, and like anything else, it takes money to run it. And but we've been hanging in there, and hopefully it'll turn around and be something very successful in the near future.
That's great. Again, it's dpqualityfoods.com. Find them online. Dan, thank you so much for taking time out of your night to be a part of the show again. It's always a privilege to get to speak
Thanks,
with you.
Chris
thank
and Bob.
You for being here.
I appreciate you guys. Thank you.
All right. Take care, Dan. All the best to you and your family.
Thank you. You too.
Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Dan Pastorini, Bob, I tell you what, a guy, we've enjoyed so many times, and I think this is Dan's fifth appearance with us on the show, but always so good to, to talk to him and hear his stories. And he's had ups and downs in the course of his, different careers, but the stories are fantastic, and what a great man he is.
Yeah, it's got so much to talk about, Chris. I mean, again, it goes all the way back to him and Archie Manning and taking beatings as youngsters, and they both got through it and went on to probably excel in other things. Obviously, Dan in drag racing and Archie in genetic exploits. So, but yeah, they're both very, very similar kind of guys. And but yeah, Dan Pastorini, fine quarterback and great gentleman, and we always love having him on.
Absolutely right. All right, we've got our next guest, Carey Davis, hanging on the line. We're going to get to Carey on the other side of this word from our friends over at Coastal Orthopedics.
Are you suffering from chronic pain in your shoulders, hips, knees, or wrists? Tired of living life with an old injury that just won't go away? If you answered yes to either of these questions, we can help. At Coastal Orthopedics and Sports Medicine, Dr. Candelora and his fine staff of medical professionals will get you back on the road to recovery. Their state-of-the-art facility and attention to detail will ensure you will be enjoying life again and feeling invincible in no time. Since 1991, Dr. Candelora and Coastal Orthopedics have been specializing in joint replacement, arthritis, and osteoporosis care, as well as pediatric and adult general orthopedics. Visit us on the web, www.bone-dr.com. Or call our Newport Richey office just north of Tampa at 727-848-1417. Proud sponsors of Mike Ditka's The Gridiron Greats Assistance Fund.
Hey, hey, welcome back. This is Todd Washington, two-time Super Bowl champ, offensive line coach for the Baltimore Ravens, and you are listening to Thursday Night Tailgate with my boys Chris Moscato and Bob Lazzari on the Armed Forces Radio Network. Go get them, guys.
Now back with us on the Kyven Foods guest line is Carey Davis. Let me remind you about Carey's background. He's from St. Louis, Missouri, played his college ball at the University of Illinois, where he was a very productive running back, running for nearly 1,800 total yards from scrimmage. He was signed as an undrafted free agent in 2004 by the Indianapolis Colts. Before I get off the Illinois piece, he graduated with his degree, folks, from Illinois in sports management. Played in the NFL from 04 to 2009 with the Colts, Falcons, Bucks, Dolphins, Redskins, and my Steelers, and was a part of the Steelers Super Bowl 43 championship team in 2008, which I remain eternally grateful for. And we're excited to have him back with us tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Carey, Chris and Bob, thanks for joining us.
Hey, guys, how's it going?
All right, how are you tonight, Carey?
I'm doing well. I'm doing great, actually.
Yeah, good for you. Carey, we were talking to Levon Kirkland a little while ago, and one of the questions I had for Levon is, you know, here we are, it's OTAs, minicamp time. So I'm curious for you, and trying to get your thoughts on what it was like, you know, going back from, you know, some time away from the game and getting back into you know, mini camps and training camps. Was it brutal going back to practice and mixing it up with the guys in the 90-degree heat up in Latrobe when you were with the Steelers?
You know, when you get ready for OTAs and mini camps and things like that, sometimes you're actually ready to get back into the swing of things. You have your time off from your football family, and you hang out with your real family, and then you get your chance to get back into the swing of things when OTAs kick back around. So, you know, sometimes it's actually fun. You miss those guys when you're not around them, and you spend a lot more time with those guys than you do with your actual family. So it's fun most of the time to get back in the swing of things, you know, and get back rolling.
So when the heat's turned up and, you know, you guys are mixing it up, and we hear about scrums all the time in camp, did you ever lose your temper during practice or training camp and get involved in a scrum?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, we, you know, it's hot outside. You're running into the same people for 2 or 3 weeks at a time. And you know, after that second or third week, you're really frustrated and ready to go hit someone else, but that person is still there. So sometimes the frustrations boil over and you know, it those scraps and those fights do take place in training camp.
So when all of that happens, I'm curious, you know, so the next piece, right, you know, practice is over, you've gotten in a scrum with, you know, whoever, you know, it's with, now you're back in the locker room. Can you compartmentalize that and say, you know what, that was just something that happened in practice? Or does it carry over into the locker room and you're looking at the guy across the room going, you know what?
No, it's usually done on the field. I mean, it's usually done after that period, after that horn blows or that whistle blows to break it up. You know, usually guys shake it up and dap it up, and you're good to go. It doesn't carry over for much longer after that happens.
So, Carey, you know, you're a young guy, 34 years old. You know, you could still be out there playing. Do you miss it?
Yeah, I do. I miss it all the time. I mean, but you know, my brain is telling me that I can still do it, but my body tells me every day, no, thank you. So, you know, I. Mentally, I miss it, but physically, yeah, I know that that my run is long over, so I have to accept that.
Carey, as I said, you know, being part of the Steelers Super Bowl championship team back in 2008, you know, I'm curious, you know, what that feels like, and in particular, you know, the clock hits zero, you guys are going crazy out on the field, and, you know, so that euphoria is there, and then when you get back into the locker room and celebrating with your teammates, what's that like? What's it like to be in the locker room, you know, with the champagne flying everywhere and, Super Bowl champs?
You know, for me, it was very sweet because we had the game was played in Tampa, and Tampa was a team that I was on the practice squad for, and they actually cut me two times. You know, so I played well in the preseason in Tampa. I thought I had done enough to make the team. And, you know, to be on the Pittsburgh team, to win the Super Bowl in Tampa, I kind of lost it a little bit there at the end. We had to take a couple of knees, and I remember Willie Colon had to grab me and get me together for those two knees that we had to take to end the game. You know, it's just – it was an emotional time for all of us. I mean, it's what you dream about as a kid to see that confetti fall, to you know, kiss that Lombardi trophy and hold it and pass it around. It's what you always dream about. So when you get that opportunity to do it, you know, that's a memory that I'll never forget.
So, you know, to that end, you're back in the locker room, and Tampa Bay has cut you a couple of times. Spray a little extra champagne on the walls or on the floor to get, you know what, remember this.
You know what, we didn't get champagne. We just had to celebrate with ourselves. We didn't get the champagne to spray around the locker room. I'm not sure if that's
really?
I think that's just a baseball and football. I mean, excuse me, baseball and basketball thing. We didn't have champagne in the locker room, so you know, unfortunately, I would have loved.
No kidding. Give you any of that when you get back to the locker room. What are you celebrating with? Just you know, you're high fiving each other.
High fives and you get to pass around that Lombardi trophy. Coach Tomlin would always speak about, you know, getting to hold that sticky Lombardi.
Yes.
It becomes very sticky when a bunch of guys have their fingerprints on it, you know, and their lips have kissed it, and you don't even worry about all of that. You grab it, you kiss it, you hold it, and that's what you do once you get back into that locker room.
Wow. I don't know, I'm a little disappointed. No champagne. Bob, questions for Carey? I'm a little taken back.
Yeah, you know, these guys are the ultimate teammates. Chris, you know I love tight ends and fullbacks. To me, again, Carey, they're the ultimate teammates. Mm-hmm. You're in the trenches. You don't get the credit. A lot of the other guys do. And you really learn a lot about yourself. You know, you probably had days in the past where you were a star on teams and mm-hmm. you were the man. And then you get to a point where you're the ultimate team man, and you. I think you just learn a lot about life, and it's probably something that you look back on now, and you probably think, "Man, I was privileged to do what I did."
Yeah, definitely. I mean, playing fullback, you know, playing football in general is the ultimate team sport. I mean, you can have 10 guys doing something perfectly sound, and one guy could mess up, and the whole play is ruined, offensively and defensively, and special teams. So, you know, it's the ultimate team sport for guys to come together. Work for your brother, work for the guy playing next to you. You know, it's a selfless game. And fullback, offensive line, you know, some tight end positions are selfless positions as well. So, you know, you just have to have that mentality that whatever is best for the team, whatever will get us an opportunity to win this game, whatever give us an opportunity to win the championship, that's what I'm willing to do and that's what I want to do. So, you know, for me, it's fun. It's exciting to block for Willie Parker and make sure and watch him run make a 15-yard run, just as it is for me to catch a pass out the backfield and do something special for myself. So that's kind of the mentality that you have is whatever's best for the team, we're going to do that and we're going to win.
Yeah. And I remember Parker well, man, and that was one guy who could run. And we talked to Levon Kirkland about speed in general, Carey. You know, some guys, it comes naturally. Some guys have to work on it. As a fullback, I would think it's important in some ways, but your off-season workouts probably centered more around strength training. Give us a typical day on what you would be doing maybe in June on your off-seasons.
Well, when I was at home, I trained in St. Louis. I would go home and train in St. Louis, and I would work out with guys like Isaac Bruce and Aeneas Williams, and we would mm-hmm. get on the track. We would do 400s, 800s, 200s. That would be our – you know, that baseline to get your wind right, get you prepared in that respect to be able to run and play all day. And then you get in the weight room and take care of your business in that regard as well. So, you know, it was waking up at 6, 7 in the morning and going to the track with two future Hall of Famers, one in the Hall of Famer and one future Hall of Famer. So that was kind of my off season, keeping up with those guys and you know, it's amazing to see those guys work and how their work ethic was. It would push me to work even harder. So a typical day for me would be waking up and getting out there and trying to compete and keep up with those guys and then getting in the weight room and pushing myself to make sure that I was as strong as I could possibly be.
Impressive.
Carey, let's talk a little bit about your time at the University of Illinois. Back in 2001, you guys finished the season ranked 12th, but you were as high as number 7 heading into the Sugar Bowl against LSU. Talk about how good that Illinois team was.
Oh, man, that was probably, you know, that was an awesome season and a great season for Illinois football, the University of Illinois in general. We had studs, man. We had guys all over the field offensively, you know, defensively. That was actually the 2001 season. Offensively, defensively, a lot of guys got drafted. A lot of guys played big time in the NFL. And, you know, everyone made plays. I mean, I think that's the one thing that I can say about that team. We had 4 wide receivers that all played in the NFL. You know, 2 of them undrafted, 2 of them that were drafted, and Brandon Hood is still playing. He's still going strong. But we had a great team offensively and defensively. We had guys that got after the quarterback, and you know, it's amazing, you know, now to look back at it, 13, 14 years ago, and think about all the success that we had. I'm actually right now down at Florida International with my former head coach, who is the head coach at Florida International now, Ron Turner. I've been helping him with his football camp for the last week. So it's kind of fun to go over the memories and think about all the things that you got, that you went through, you know, all the hard work, all the times where you were frustrated and didn't see the light at the end of the tunnel. But, you know, to have the success that we had as a team was an awesome experience.
Over the 4 years you were at Illinois, you guys never beat Michigan. In fact, you know, had you beaten them early in that 2001 season, you guys would have probably been playing for the national championship that year because you would have been undefeated in the regular season. How much do you hate Michigan still?
I hate Michigan a lot. I mean, you know, I have to correct you, though. In 99, I got to Illinois in 99, and we did beat Michigan and Ohio State on the road. So we did beat them then. But, you know, losing that game at Michigan in 2001 was it was a tough deal, man, because, you know, when you look at it, you know, we would have been, 11-0 going into the bowl season and had an opportunity to be national champs. And the crazy thing is the national championship game was in the Rose Bowl. So we didn't even go to the Rose Bowl, even though we won the Big Ten and were Big Ten champs. We ended up at the Sugar Bowl playing LSU, which was tough sledding for us. And we got beat up. We got handled pretty handedly in that game, especially in the first half. But, you know, looking back on it, man, I'm proud of what we did, what we were able to accomplish, because I know the hard work that was put in by those guys in that locker room, and I know the sacrifice and dedication that we all had, because, you know, we no one believed that we were capable of doing it except for us. And to go out there and actually accomplish what we did, it was amazing.
Bob, one more for Carey before we let him go.
Yeah, definitely, Carey. Earlier in the show, Chris mentioned your schooling and how you got your degree. And to me, you'd be the man to speak with, having a semi-short career in the NFL, but having to fall back on your education. How often, Carey, do you get the chance to speak to upcoming football players or kids in general about the importance of a college degree?
Oh, I mean, I talk to kids all the time. And that's usually the first thing I tell them. It doesn't matter how good you are in football. It doesn't matter how fast you are, how high you jump, you know, how athletic you are, how far you can throw a football or catch it and all of that good stuff. If your grades aren't together, if you're not capable of handling your business inside of a classroom, you know, nobody will ever know how good or talented you could have been, because you won't have that chance or that opportunity to go to the next level. So, you know, academics, and I know a lot of kids, you know, don't believe it. They don't listen to it. They get frustrated and don't want to hear it. But, you know, the only way that they'll learn is by actually going through that and having to learn that lesson on their own. And you don't want them to have to do that. You want them to listen to what you're telling them and be able to understand how important those grades are, how important that ACT, SAT is, and making sure you put yourself in a position to be successful. But, you know, unfortunately, some kids have to learn the hard way and have to go the JUCO route. But if I could say anything to anybody that may be listening, any young kids, any parents of young kids, you know, it's your responsibility. It's not your coach's responsibility. It's not the college coach's responsibility. It's your responsibility as a parent. It's your responsibility as a young man to make sure that your grades are up to par in order to get a scholarship. And, you know, who doesn't want to go to school for free? If you can go to school for free, that's the best thing in the world. So As a parent, I'm a parent of three. I make sure that I stay on my kids' grades, and parents of potential high school or potential college recruits have to do the same thing. And even if you're not a college recruit, you should probably stay on your kids' grades anyway. So that's my two cents for the parents and the future ball players out there.
I think Chris will agree. We probably just heard our greatest public service announcement we've ever heard.
Right. Absolutely right. That's great stuff, Carey. Thank you so much for putting that out there and for being a part of the show tonight. You're always a treat to have on, you know, as a Steeler fan, you know, hearing the stories about your time with the Steelers and the Super Bowl piece. I got so many other questions I'd love to ask. And I love that you mentioned the Sticky Lombardi, because I always get a kick out of hearing Mike Tomlin refer to it as the Sticky Lombardi. But, Carey, thanks for taking time out of your night and for being a part of the show. We hope you'll come back again sometime real soon to share more of your insights with us.
All right, guys. I appreciate it. Thanks so much for having me.
All right. Take care, Carey.
Thank you.
Carey Davis, former Steelers, and he played in a bunch of organizations. Bob, I'm still throwing back a little, Bob. No champagne in the locker room?
I don't know if they were in shock, Chris, or just wanted to get their hands on it, and just time kind of ran away from them. But, yeah, true. I mean, what a career. I mean, short, but has a lot of impact on a lot of people, Chris. Great guy, and what a role model. I mean, what he said at the end, man, I was like, I've heard it before from other guys, but the way he put it, that's the guy that you should listen to, because he's the poster boy for that type of how important a college degree is.
Yeah, no, exactly right. That was great stuff. All right, Bob, it's time for us to put a bow on this one. But before we do, I want to make a quick announcement. Tomorrow, our friend Moosin Muhammad, Moose is going to he owns a Wild Wings Cafe franchise out in Hilton Head, South Carolina. So this weekend, they're going to be celebrating a 25th birthday bash for Wild Wings Cafes, and then tomorrow night they're having a 25th VIP happy hour from 5 to 7 at his Wild Wings Cafe there. It's located at 72 Pope Avenue, so if you're on or near Hilton Head, go meet Moose tomorrow and have a great time. They are following that event with a beach bash on Sunday, so you need a great place to take Dad on Father's Day. Take him to the 25th beach bash for Wild Wings Cafe there on Hilton Head Island. They're going to be bringing the beach to their parking lot, so they're going to be having live music and all kinds of fun things starting Sunday at noon. So go check that out. Again, it's located at the Wild Wings Cafe at 72 Pope Avenue on Hilton Head Island. Take Dad. Have a great time. All right, Bob. So, you know, next week, who do we have with us? Well, next week is going to be another great night for us here on Thursday Night Tailgate. Former Cowboys tight end Doug Cosby is going to be back with us, and he is doing some great stuff to bring attention to the head trauma issue that that his peers, you know, some of his former peers are dealing with now. So we look forward to hearing about the project that Doug is working on when he joins us next week. Another TNT alum that will be coming home is former Jaguars and Bucks wide receiver and kick returner, and a guy who should now be out on the Bassmasters tour because he's such an outstanding fisherman, and that's Reggie Barlow. So we look forward to talking not only football, but a little fishing with Reggie when he's back with us next week. Our friend and former Rams and Titans linebacker Will Witherspoon will also be making a return visit with us. Plus, Dr. Steven Novicki of Shockstrip is going to be joining us again, and he's going to update us on the progress that he's making with teams and organizations embracing his product that helps reduce some of the impact from helmet-to-helmet contact. We've had Doc on the show many times, and we're a big supporter of teams utilizing that product. And, Bob, it always amazes me, why wouldn't you? Why wouldn't you do more? I mean, it always drove, you know, Angie and I crazy for the first couple of years on this show. You and I now over the last couple of years, you know, if there's a product out there that can help reduce the impact from helmet to helmet contact, why isn't everyone using it? It doesn't make any sense to me. And we'll have Doc come back and share his thoughts on that, Bob.
Yeah, common sense. And we don't see a lot of that these days, but when it comes to the seriousness of the subject matter, people better get on it.
Yeah, no, I couldn't agree with that statement more. And then, of course, we'll have our 12th man segment with Sports One Marketing CEO David Meltzer and his special guest next week. So another great show lined up for you guys next week. We hope you'll come back and be a part of it. Want to remind you how you can follow us on Twitter and over social media. Obviously, our Facebook page, Thursday Night Tailgate, go check that page out and give us a like. That's important to us, too. You can find me on Twitter, at CT Mascaro. Bob is at Bob_Lazzari, and the show is at TNT Podcast. So please check us out on there. And if you've got a question that you want to ask a future guest on the show or a comment, please reach out to us there. We appreciate that very much. Plus, you can stay up to date with some of who our future guests are going to be, and you can stream or download any of our archive episodes, like I say, for free now by going to our website, ThursdayNightTailgate.com. Bob, take us home, my friend.
A lot of fun with some great guests, and thanks as usual, Chris. And also thanks to our announcer, Joe LaGenusa, for the great job he does with our weekly intro and ads. And to Kyle Turley, Tim Pickett, and all our friends over at Gridiron Records for their partnership and our upcoming outro music. On behalf of myself and Chris, we thank everyone out there for listening tonight. We appreciate you the most. Until next week, good night, Kevin. Keep fighting.
Coming down the mountain, I take a breath of sin. Can't tell the day or time, but I know this day will end. On a mission I can't